Back here on another episode of the Tech Report with my friend and fellow podcaster, Mr. Rob Gimes. How you doing?
I am hanging out and getting ready to get on a plane for my first trip to Asia since COVID started.
Oh, wow. Okay. Well, good for you, man. This will be good. Man, it's been a long time since I've been to Singapore or some of the Asian markets. You know, that's where I started my tech career.
In Asia?
Yeah, working for Microsoft.
Oh, you know, now, first of all, you would think that I would know that you worked for Microsoft because what I'm doing over there, what I'm going to see. So there's a couple things that actually I'm pretty excited about. It's not about getting on a plane for 14 hours, but it's actually about some of the technology and the things that come out of them. And in some of our past episodes that we've done since we got this started, you know, we covered drive-through, mm-hmm. and even some of the pictures that you used in that, you know, I'm very interested in looking at drive-through, the double-decker restaurants, limited service, robotics, you know, and going to Singapore and Bangkok.
You'll get a chance to see some crazy stuff over there, I think.
I'm trying to figure out what to do with an eight-hour layover in Tokyo. I am thinking about, do I have enough time to get and visit the tech district or something? I could leave the airport. So anyway, but I'm excited about it. And even for the subject, which we're going to talk about today, I think that, you know, things like delivery and online, you know, people know our subject or are about to know our subject.
Yeah.
But even things like that, those applications were not started in the U.S. They were started
in many cases.
Like,
you're exactly right.
India, it's kind of like drone Dubai, delivery. You know. So anyway, so I turn it over to you. I'm very excited about doing this.
We are going to be cutting into third-party delivery. Does it make sense for restaurant operators in today's tech world? Because there's so many options. We're going to jump right into it. You guys don't want to miss this one. All right, Rob, we are back here and we are talking third-party delivery. And when you look at third-party delivery, really what you have to consider is pre-COVID and post-COVID, because that's really what it boils down to. The game changed in 2020. A lot of new players, obviously we saw, you know, the potential of explosion over time. We'll show some charts here in a minute on where this is going. But what do you think the current state of third-party delivery is right now? Would you say this is an A plus or are we a C minus?
I don't think we know where we're going yet. And when I say that, we don't know where we're going to end up. And the reason for that is actually going to be because of technology. And third-party delivery, that's sort of an interesting set of terminology because you have the applications that run it, which is the online ordering.
Right.
Okay. You have the pickup, which is a segment which may not exactly be delivery. And so I just sort of look at it, you know, you used to have an off-premise or an on-premise show, right? So I'm thinking about this for a second. What we're really talking about is outside of the food service establishment. And so third-party delivery is one component of delivery.
Right.
But you've got pickup and everything else. So I think it's there. I think it's changing, but how and the methods are going to be technology driven.
The thing that I have noticed here recently is the amount of integration that third party is doing as a, I won't call it as a messaging point, but I always follow the media of where these companies are trying to essentially get restaurants to, you know, organize behind third party. One thing that surprised me was this right here. This is the PNC website. So this is PNC
Bank. My bank.
Yeah. Okay. Well, there you go. This was just here May of this year, how to integrate your restaurant with third-party delivery service. So they clearly have been approached by one of the big guys, if not the big guy. Because remember, all restaurants start, you know, a banking relationship. They get into, you know, the process of, you know, their journey and running their business. And usually one of the first things is, you know, what are some of the services? I was surprised to see a bank presenting third-party delivery systems out there.
Why? You know what? They do a lot of small businesses. And what I look at is, I saw right through that when you put that up there. I thought to myself, hey, wait a second. Now, what is it? Why would a bank, why would PNC, you know, be interested? And then immediately I go right to credit card transactions.
Exactly.
And that they're a payment processor, because they hit me up all the time for it. Mm-hmm. You know, we use them actually for the IFBTA. So they need to do small businesses, and they want small businesses to do more and more transactions, and more transactions is more dollars in the bank, but it also is transactions through credit card processing, through payroll, and all the other things that they're offering.
Yeah. Well, I think the key here is with the restaurant industry, there has been a little bit of a pushback now. Obviously, there's been a time when third party, I would say most likely saved maybe 15 to 20% of the restaurant industry during COVID. I would give them that credit. Now, granted, there's been some situations where that has been, I would dare to say, predatory to a certain extent on a lot of operators. The ones I talk with, they're still in that zone of they're not sure. And this is something that is starting to percolate. Here's another website just showing you the alternative of what's out there. So this is coming in to say, all right, well, how about you as a restaurant operator, this is how you should go get customers to order through your app and not a third party. Now, this is I have a story for you. It actually happened last night. And what happened was I ordered takeout from a Thai restaurant that I always love to go to. I know exactly what I'm going to order every week. We have a certain night, Thai night. Same order. So it's, you know, it's almost ingrained into my brain how much that is going to be, that ticket.
And so last Thai night is not like a formal night out, right?
No. This is takeout. I call it in. I go by and pick it up. So I refuse to use third-party delivery, just so everybody knows. I don't trust people delivering my food anymore after other issues. But that's a trauma. Deal.
Larry David or was it on Seinfeld? You know how many whatever it was in the Chinese food. I forget what it was. Was it the noodles or it was like the number
there.
Of dumplings or something?
Here's, let me get back to the story here. So I get there, I'm getting ready to pay, and the price is like 30% more. And I'm like, wait a minute, did they change their prices? And they're scrambling around the point of sale system. They're trying to figure out what would happen. And what they had done by mistake was they had applied all the Uber pricing to their entire menu. By mistake. They had been overcharging every customer in that restaurant by 30%. I'm standing there in a line of about five people, and one guy just got his order and said, wait a minute. Oh my gosh, it just caused a small
riot. How long
riot.
Have they been doing it?
Yeah, how long? We don't know. That's the point.
That's so, like when you don't know that you're not getting the proper credit card transaction fees.
Yeah,
in there.
It's terrible.
It's the same thing.
But the difference was, is I think it the reality was, even to someone like me, you know, the price of that, it's insignificant really. But at the same time, it was enough for it to just catch my personal attention. And I thought, okay, this has to be bad for consumers and for the operators together. There's just no way that a consumer can handle this kind of upcharge. How long do you think this is going to happen?
Well, that's really interesting because a number of things. Before COVID, when people were taking a look at delivery, the whole argument was, do we embed it into our fees or do we charge it separately as a service charge?
Right.
You know, and how much do we pass on and do we limit the charge to a per trip, whatever it was? And of course, everybody was debating, you know, do we deliver ourselves or do we do, you know, third parties? And then you had COVID hit. And so the whole discussion as to whether we're going to deliver, first of all, went by the wayside. And secondly, you know, you had to use third parties, especially in some remote areas, you know, where you couldn't get to people. You wanted to deliver what you were doing because your people weren't going to deliver and you weren't set up. So
no
today
doubt.
We accept that that's what it is. But the fees are always part of the challenge. But it's not just that. It's credit card fees as well. I went, you know, during the NRA show to Chicago and half the restaurants there are charging an upcharge, you know, well.
Where you're paying a credit card fee.
They're not charging credit card. They do in Atlantic City and in that area, they say if you pay with a credit card, 3% or whatever. But there, they're charging what they would call a service fee, a convenience fee, which I don't think is very convenient. And I'm thinking at some of these places, why don't you just raise your price by 2 or 3%. Mm-hmm. You know, I won't know the difference in there. But in your case, you did notice the difference, and it made you think twice.
Yeah, it was a significant leap.
That's right. But I think sooner or later, that's all going to come together, right? You know,
how do these companies maintain profitability if they're not really profitable yet? You know, whether you look at Uber Eats or you look at Postmates, DoorDash, etc. Here's a good example of a chart, you know, just to show you the expansion. For everybody, if you're not watching the podcast, right, make sure and visit us over at saver.fm. You'll catch our full video version of this. But this is meal delivery, monthly sales. This goes back to, you know, pre-2020, right, obviously pre-COVID. So you can kind of see that zone right there between 19 and 20. Much lower under that 200, what is that, million mark. Mm-hmm. And then it just continues to grow.
Right.
As you can see here.
But you need to know why it's growing, right? So the question is, you know, before COVID, every restaurateur, I could do a quiz with you. You better know the answer to this. But, you know, how do you measure the success of a restaurant?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's going to be check average, you know, yep, average cover. You know, yep, it's going to be table turn. It's going to be how many visits per month. And the holy grail prior to COVID was, can I get people to come back an extra visit a month,
right?
Well, I think what's happened here is the real question you want to know about that chart is that incremental sales, because you've now created a new day part, like drive-through is a day part to QSR, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm, have you created a new day part and they're now actually visiting you an extra time a month? They're just eating it at home because you now, right, convince them they can do that, right? And you'll deliver to them, by the way, so they don't have to pick up, they don't have to prepare. So in order to really look at that chart, the question is, is it incremental or is it taking the place of something else? If it's incremental and now you have these fees and third party in there, well, that's the cost of doing the business.
Yeah.
You know, but if it's taking away from your existing business and other things you're doing, you know, that's a different story altogether.
One thing I think when you look at this chart, is that the date, you know, it's just clear, obviously pandemic, but here's the thing, it continues to climb. And the scenario that I'm seeing, and this is something we track in the Power Index in terms of loyalty, the number of frequency visits, we look at the big brands on the RPI. And one thing we're seeing more and more is that there is a decline in loyalty, that's for sure, especially in Gen Z. More so than any. We just did a big piece on this. But the other thing is that the training of third party has been ingrained into society, that delivery is just a thing. I'll play a video for you to give you some examples of that.
Just like kiosk is a thing and just like online ordering is a thing.
Yeah, so I just wonder if we will get into a space where much like over time, you know, that's all it takes is time, you know, because we've kind of went from not flying, not going to conferences, not getting it and eating out of restaurants. We've moved ourselves back into that. And there's people out there that have said, I remember, they said, I'll never go to a conference again.
Exactly.
Okay. And that, of course, has changed. I think we are starting to see a decline in third-party delivery. And I think these companies are destined for failure.
So
somebody's going to take over.
So, okay. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Somebody's going to take over. You read my mind. So yep. I thought about this for a second. There's two pieces of history we have to look at here. One, I don't want to forget something you brought up at the very top of this show. One of them has to do with, are people going to try to find ways around taking those orders in the consolidation to have them taken on themselves? Well, yep. We talked about this in the past. Go look at both the airline industry and the hotel industry when they had people that came in that you would go ahead and price line and things like that. You'd go ahead and mm-hmm. do it there. And the companies, the brands said, we have to take this back, you know? And so they took it back and they came up with strategies to have you go to their website and create the loyalty and book and not get these deals and stuff. So both exist today. However, the bigger thing that I think in here is what percentage of people, and by the way, you mentioned your index, so I'd like to know about the sentiment of this, but what percentage of people are in fact saying it's okay, but you know what? I want to order my goods from Amazon. Let them be the consolidator. And then for the independent restaurateurs, we could sit there and say, you know, I want to go ahead and order from one of the individual customized online ordering apps that specializes in one-offs and high-ends and things that are out there. So are we going to end up with a consolidation like where Amazon is picking it up and now all the retailers flock to put their stores on there rather than doing themselves, which then cuts out a lot of the other ways of doing it? Is that what's going to happen to us here?
Well, I think the key is a couple. One is I think there will be, you know, we'll start to see big integrations that will be outside of the future of where, you know, Uber Eats and et cetera will go. And one thing I want to show you, just to give you an example, I'm going to share something else instead, and we're going to share a window. This one right here. This is the App Store currently on... yeah, that's good. Yeah, the App Store. I'm going to bring it up on screen right now. So we're going to go to the App Store on Apple. And what I'm looking at right here is the results for food delivery. Okay, the number one is Food Lion. Okay, but you got Burger King coming in, Papa John's, Food Panda, obviously for food and groceries, Chow Now, interesting, food. And then you continue to see none of the majors. There's McDonald's. And then you see a handful of others, and then Jersey Mike's. So what I'm thinking is that
you probably don't see the majors because you went and said food delivery. If you just said online ordering, gee, I wonder what would happen.
Well, let's test it. You know,
and no, we're going to do this real time. Okay.
Yeah.
So I mean, you know, delivery is very specific, and so online ordering, I would hope we would see those coming up.
No, that's not going to. It's going to give you more order management kind of stuff.
Online restaurant. I would okay. So online restaurant ordering.
Ooh, you're really going.
Well, I'm trying to think of what I would actually look up if I were doing a search here. I'd say not for an app.
I would say not that. But the point is that we're starting to see a lot of movement. I think of restaurant apps. I'm just always love to go into the App Store and kind of look at what you know some of the best new apps are. But anyway, the point being is that you've got restaurants starting to integrate a lot more of their own apps.
Right.
So that's removing that. And they're giving benefits for that. I think we're going to start to see some decentralized components into this.
I agree.
Totally.
Follow the history. Yep. Follow the history.
Google is most likely going to integrate this into search, and or AI will integrate a commerce component that I imagine will start to link into some of the main services that are out there. Now,
absolutely.
Granted, it would be an easy fit. You know, if you look at someone, you probably have to look at Elon, his new AI startup. He's got X.com and he's got Tesla. And if the future of all this really does get into place, because I still believe robo-taxi will be a thing and autonomy will completely cut out.
So autonomous vehicles delivering food and picking up food will lower the cost and get rid of some of the drivers. But are we talking about something different here?
No, that may be. So if you think about the integration of everything Elon is doing, because remember X.com, he comes from PayPal. X.com was supposed to be, that's where he actually reinvigorated X.com because that was originally what PayPal was going to be called.
And let's not forget that Noah Glass at Olo came from, what was it, Twitter?
I didn't know Noah came over from Twitter.
He either came over from Twitter or I think so, or something like that. That's where Noah came from.
Interesting. I did not know that about Noah. Huh.
There you go.
Well, one thing to note is you've got three elements for Elon, and the third element just went into play this, you know, 2 weeks ago when Elon launched his AI startup. So he's got Tesla, which is distribution. You've got marketing and media, which is X.com, and possibly because he's already getting these money licenses, and I think is it 23 or more states now where he can do money transmitter licenses, meaning you could move money on X. So if that becomes a factor, he could literally leapfrog the entire ordering system, meaning food delivery, transactions, commerce, et cetera, if you're tying in that. The only thing I think that he would need to really piece all this together would be AI, and he's, you know, in the midst of doing that. So all of these companies, whether it's OpenAI, whether it's Google, Microsoft, will start to see, I think we'll see a lot more options coming at us for food delivery and also food ordering just in general, just because of the perception of, you know, consumer preferences. But this, I think, is on its way out. How long before we start to see the death of Uber Eats?
Yeah, you know, I'm not sure they get acquired, or maybe it's the death of Uber Eats or the rebirth of Amazon, whatever it was, because Amazon,
they were trying to, yeah, they tried to do it.
They did, and then they got out. But maybe it just morphs itself. Because the question is there the death of Uber general, you know? Mm-hmm. And I find it interesting, by the way, that the founder of Uber was the keynote speaker at the Food on Demand conference months ago.
Well, I mean, Noah, of course, obviously with Olo, big connection point. Olo has not been doing well in the public markets, but, you know, when you look at Olo in general, they are pretty much the gateway for e-commerce ordering for the food service industry, and have kind of done that over a couple of, probably about the last 15 years now, you know, from that entire growth model. But that's my question is, do we get a leapfrog technology here that completely circumvents the system as we know it, which is, you know, the typical credit card transaction, the typical e-commerce hooks, the typical third-party delivery mechanisms that you have to tie right in to make all this work. And even to a certain extent, the point of sale integrations, you know, down the road. Are any of the POS guys that you're talking about this kind of future?
Well, now that's a really interesting question, because you'd have to be a pretty darn big one. I think that the POS guys stay sort of fluid in this because they know they're going to have to integrate with whatever, but I don't think that they're thinking about getting into the business. Now, the real question here is whether the retail side of this would get into that business and how do they integrate? So if I were to expand my thinking just a little bit here, okay, and let's just be not as focused on this. You know, who exactly are the big players at a show like NRF with big booths in retail? Well, SAP
yep.
is in there. Salesforce is in there. Microsoft. So if you start and I'm aware, by the way, that SAP is in the POS business. Microsoft is in the POS business too. You just may not see it, and they certainly have the financial end of it. Mm-hmm. So the question is it going to be one of those players if you expand your thing? Because when you said the word POS to me, I think about the traditional POS players and who the big ones are. But if you take a look at some of the really big ones and who they're funded by and who's the backbone, like Oracle, you know, now expanded thinking, they're possibly is an opportunity there where they do get into the business because of other businesses are in fueling e-commerce. You know, I listen to radio when I'm driving, and all these commercials all of a sudden for Oracle Cloud have come up. That, boy, that sounds like AWS to me, but they're running an awful lot of commercials in that. And so if AWS is running e-commerce for all these companies, including a lot of food service companies, you know, so I think we need to change our definition. The answer, that was a long-winded answer to probably yes, but it's not going to be your traditional POS players because you asked the question that way.
Yeah, well, I think that's the key is that we might be on the brink of another major shift in tech, you know, because you look at the evolution of point of sale, the connectivity of things like Olo and others that have been able to kind of tie in the e-commerce center. And the other thing that plays into this is, of course, the transaction side of it, which is going to be the merchant services, which have always been, you know, kind of the process that we've seen, even though we've seen the rise of Stripe here recently. And there's been a lot of change there. However, with everything that we cover, like over on PBN, we talk so much about these payment processors, especially with what we think will change the entire payment ecosystem, which is going to get into blockchain payment, stable coins, things of that nature. Mm-hmm. If that occurs, and I do believe it will, it is going to circumvent and it's going to open up an opportunity, I think, for big companies, whether it's big companies or even startups, to kind of revolutionize the e-commerce space, especially
right.
around food delivery.
Well, I think you're right. I think you're right. And, you know, also the question would be, do some of the big brands, you know, they've dabbled in it. They mm-hmm. bought food delivery and online ordering.
Well,
and they got out of it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Do they get back in it? I'm not sure. You know,
well, I think the key here is, in many cases, if you're buying something today that's not a bleeding edge startup, then you're already behind, because you've got to buy stuff that is 3 years out, because that's how long it takes for the integration side of it.
Right. So if you, again, if you're in the hotel or the airline industry, and you buy an airline ticket or a hotel, and you buy it through one of the online ordering platforms, those platforms, you know, Sabre, which was originally owned and founded by American Airlines, you know, is the back end of a lot of the different ordering platforms. And I once did a presentation somewhere and said, here's how much you pay for a room night. Here's how much you pay for an airline. But by the time it actually gets to the room and the hotel, there's all these fees that come out for the global distribution system, for the central res, for this. Everybody gets their cut. And then the travel agents. So what happened to travel agents? They got cut out, right?
Yeah.
And they got flat fees. This is deja vu. So instead of taking a look at what the problem is, which we probably could find a clip from years ago of somebody, maybe even John Oliver, complaining about those fees and talking about all the cuts, you know, in them and why that's, you know, cost so much. But we still make reservations that way. We still
I think the argument there is that when you look at, because this is an argument I've seen a lot on the travel and the air side of things. And yes, I get that, but it is completely different when it is your local neighborhood restaurant. I mean, the hospitality angle of this is a completely different expectation. There's a different relationship between the guest and the customer. I mean, the guest and the operator.
Right.
And that, I think, is the problem. So the reason I wanted to show that clip is because this is now mainstream. All right. This is mainstream. Every customer now understands that restaurant operators are dealing with these kind of fees. That's why you're dealing with a 30% upcharge, essentially, to get your Thai food. And this is a problem. And I think, you know, I would love to have, and I've invited them on the show.
You're going to invite John Oliver?
No, I'd love to have Grubhub and Uber Eats and those explain to me how this is beneficial for the restaurant industry in the future. And if there's something that is going to change, what is it? Because that, I think, is the key we're dealing with right now, is there's going to be so much technology integration, whether it's AI, the invention, or not invention, but the integration of a lot of other companies that will start to play into this zone.
So I agree with you. I agree with you about that. But if you think about it, you want to have that conversation with somebody who also has other parts and pieces of the puzzle. So for instance, Uber is a natural because, you know, they also do the cars and they, you know, have to solve that problem for the drivers. They already had the drivers, where the other ones didn't necessarily do that. So that's like you're using Elon Musk as an example here, because he's already got certain things and one feeds the other and how they do it, right?
Sure.
So I think you need to think about that, but it's a collective conversation. It's almost like a panel, because you have the order takers, you have the people that have to get you from here to there. And by the way, you can throw drones into this conversation, you know, if you want to do that, because so it's interesting, because the people taking the orders, I sat next to was DoorDash and drones, you know, talking, not Google, but DoorDash and drones talking about the bots and delivery and things like that at Food on Demand.
Yeah,
their opinion may be different than Uber, you know, who has a different style and a different method, you know, to it. So there's really a number of ways to look at this to try to get to the answer, because each one's going to answer where they see the industry going and what their vision is of how they fit in. Same as Olo, by the way, who tried to consolidate all the orders into one and has programs for that. And they bought companies, you know, to help do that.
Well, I, you know, Noah's a friend. I have known him for a long time. I hope that he is on the front end of this, because at some point, this business, I think, goes away. Technology is advancing too quickly. The payment systems are changing. And the other key thing that's changing is the way to reach customers. So sure, Uber Eats and the ride-hailing services have had kind of that captive audience of consumer data, but I think that's about to change as we start to see whether it's social integration, AI integration, or blockchain and Web3, which I think is really where it's going to happen. You know, in
right.
Terms
so
of
you do want to ask the consumer at the end of the day. They're the ones who are going to make the choice. So one of the things should be, are they happy with their choice of being able to consolidate and take the orders? Because mm-hmm. if that's going to be the channel, that's going to be the channel, right?
Right.
And by the way, we could use OpenTable as an example there.
Yeah.
You know, because that's synonymous with I'm going to go to OpenTable. You sure, you have Resy and you have the other people out there. But generally, I find, where do I go first? I go first to OpenTable to look up a restaurant. But yeah. if I go to the restaurant's website, I may end up with Resy. So it's the same sort of thing. I'd ask the consumer, how do they want to place their orders? What's convenient to them? Because they only have so much time to do this in so many apps, because that's going to give you the answer the long term. Then you have to solve the problem of the restaurateur that was interviewed there who's giving up, you know, a ton of his order share in it. But that'll yeah. probably come around.
Well, I think that, you know, there's really not a comparison in any of the services out there versus the food delivery side, because it is so laden with costs. Right. You know, you've got drivers, vehicles, the logistics side of it. You know, this was a broken system from the beginning. I get it. You know, I've always been kind of an antagonist of Uber, mainly because I just don't see the business model working long term. At some point, you know, money's going to run out. I mean, yeah, okay. I get that SoftBank and, you know, some of the biggest investors in the world are behind this. Now they, you know, they're almost right. too big to fail, you know, but it doesn't mean they won't. So we'll see. If listen, it happens slowly and then all at once. So get ready, because that's exactly how they rose to power, was it happened slowly and then bam, in 2020, all at once. So it's definitely going to be one to watch. I am watching the technology very closely, because I think there is something right. in the weeds right now waiting to pounce. I don't know what
it is. Probably is, but that's usually what happens, right? Something yep. comes out and everybody wants in on it. And that's, you know, and again, you know, maybe it's the under 40 crowd that just jumps on and starts using it because it's the coolest thing out there.
Yep. Yep.
And maybe it's a consolidator. You know, I'm not sure.
I just don't know how they would consolidate. We could get into this as a, you know, as an add-on discussion down the road, because the, you know, the infrastructure is still so laden. You know, autonomous vehicles would have been maybe one of the killer
right.
Components, because you're pulling a driver out of it. That's a huge cost, you know, for it. Now, granted, the gig worker business would go away and probably into other things, but autonomous. And I believe this, I did a video on this probably 3 or 4 years ago, and I looked at the trajectory. I'm going to try to find that video. The trajectory of robotaxis and autonomous delivery and what it would mean for the restaurant industry. It was in the trillions in terms of opportunity. Right. So,
well, I took a autonomous vehicle in Phoenix, you know, a number of months ago. However, I follow it at CES and Waymo, yeah. And at CES, I take a look at the whole autonomous vehicle pavilion. Mm-hmm. But in there, what I cover is I take a look at those that have flatbeds that they show grocery on it.
Right.
Or you go ahead and put food on it. You open it up with your phone. It picks up. It does it. So I think those are definitely coming. Although, you know, the drone guys would tell you something different, but
sure.
if you're going to have a large order picked up at multiple places, you want to deliver it all at once and keep, you know, I do think that there's probably both, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, I follow the different, it's parts and pieces. You got to put the parts and pieces. Yeah. The autonomous vehicles are
hey, that's
one.
That's how I got here.
Another.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how I got here. It was parts and pieces that got us to where we are right
Absolutely.
Now.
Absolutely.
You needed Olo for the e-commerce connectivity. You needed Uber, DoorDash, you know, et cetera, Grubhub. Then, of course, you needed all the processors. Even Stripe, to a certain extent, has a lot of integration into the future of where this is going to go.
Listen, well, go take a look at the ads that are running right now for Square, right?
Yep.
So they're now everywhere in the mm-hmm. in the retail pieces of it. And I would just point out one thing, and we'll move on, but you know, when I take a look at the Food Service Innovation Zone at NRF for next year, who was the first person in? DoorDash.
Yeah.
Hmm. We didn't even mention them. Yeah, but we didn't mention them. And this is a innovation zone that's, you know, focused on food service, restaurants, and delivery as part of it. And DoorDash decided to put their name, you know, up there at the front, and the other guys mm-hmm. are coming in. But there's a player you don't see much in the restaurant delivery game today, and that's part of the, you know, showing of the crossover of restaurants and retail.
Yeah. It's going to be a big one. Rob, we're going to cover lots of topics like this for everybody that's watching today or listening over on the podcast side of things. Make sure and subscribe. If you're here on the YouTube channel, make sure and smash a like and also give us a comment down below. We've been starting to pick up a little bit of audience here on YouTube, so thank you so much for stopping in there. And Rob, I'll see you next week. We're going to have a good one.
Great. I'll look forward to it.
Always. We'll catch you next time right here on the Tech Report. Here again, let's jump into it today. The Tech Report, which will become the number one technology podcast in the world. I believe this, I'm manifesting it out right now. You and me, we're gonna do it right here. It's gonna be fun.
If we're gonna talk technology, it might as well be fun.